Signor Presidente, dear Chairman, Meneer de Gouverneur, Meneer de Burgemeester, Excellencies, dear colleagues, dear students, ladies and gentlemen. Per il Collegio d'Europa è un grande onore poter dar il benvenuto al Presidente Giorgio Napolitano in occasione dell'apertura dell'anno accademico 2011-2012. Following our chairman, allow me to express the gratitude of the College of Europe to President Napolitano for having accepted to take part in this ceremony marking the opening of the academic year 2011-2012 here in Bruges. And as our chairman just mentioned, we feel particularly honored by the presence of a European head of state who inspires as much respect as you do, Mr. President. This afternoon, I'm supposed to report briefly on the College of Europe in 2011 and then present the patron of the new promotion, Marie Skłodowska-Curie. However, since we are the College of Europe, allow me to say first a few words concerning the current state of the European Union, which is, as just mentioned, at a critical juncture. We know that the European Union is going through a severe financial and economic crisis, and that in order to overcome that crisis, there is a need for European leaders capable of true statesmanship. The depth of the crisis which hits Europe is due, in fact, to a lack of Europe. It is striking to observe that the economic figures for the Eurozone taken as a whole are not worse, but rather better than for the United States, Japan, or the United Kingdom. However, as one knows, the Eurozone suffers from a lack of homogeneity. That was a fact at the start, but it's a fact that has not been corrected since then, because monetary union has not been accompanied by a form of economic union, which itself requires a significant degree of political union. And we also know that the imperfect substitute that had been put in place, the so-called Maastricht criteria, could not be effectively enforced by the European institutions, starting with the Council, the representative organ of the Member States. To put an end to the crisis afflicting the Eurozone and beyond the entire European Union, more Europe is needed. A Europe where responsibility and solidarity can be combined. A Europe which also shows to the citizens that if indeed sacrifices cannot be avoided in the short term, there is hope that economic and social progress can resume in a not too distant future. That is the historical task which European leaders have to fulfill in the months ahead, starting this evening in Brussels. If they do not, the European integration process might start unraveling, because a failure of the euro is likely to translate into a failure of the internal market. At the same time, the unique European experiment in integration through democratic means would lose its power of attraction in the eyes of the Europeans, in the eyes of our neighbors, and in the eyes of the world at large. And the voice of Europe in the world would grow dim. Coming now to the College of Europe, I should first mention that this year we are hosting 435 graduate students, 315 in Bruges, 120 at Natelin campus, representing 56 different nationalities, among whom, Mr. President, we count 48 Italian nationals, 35 here in Bruges, 13 in Natelin. Together, the latter represent the second largest group here at the college. The college continues to try to widen its student recruitment. However, here much depends on the availability of scholarships. Some countries and regions in Europe have had to reduce their contribution because of budgetary difficulties. On the other hand, there is also good news. The number of ENP scholarships, European Neighborhood Policy Scholarships, has considerably increased, and this thanks to the European Parliament. The number of scholarships for Turkish graduates has also gone up. And recently, we have been informed that the Lombardia region would offer a significant number of scholarships to graduates of the region starting next academic year. Banco Santander will also finance additional scholarships. In order to strengthen its academic programs, the college is increasing its permanent academic staff. I should mention here in particular the creation of a new chair focusing on the European neighborhood policy at our Natalin campus. The college is also investing in the consolidation and strengthening of its relation with its vast alumni network. And in passing, I would like to inform you that one of our alumni, Ms. Helle Thorning-Schmidt, has become Prime Minister of Denmark. For the College of Europe, this is a first. For until now, we had to satisfy ourselves, if I may say so, with alumni becoming Minister for Foreign Affairs, Minister for European Affairs, or Vice Prime Minister, as in the United Kingdom. In wat je nu in verband met het college en de Stadbrugge, zoals u waarschijnlijk reeds weet, is de tweede fase van de restauratie van Verversdijk nu volop aan de gang. En het loopt heel goed. We hopen dat de volledige restauratie van Verversdijk voltooid kan worden begin 2013. En zoals vorig jaar vermeld werd, zal het grootste gedeelte van de kosten gedekt worden door de steun van de Vlaamse regering in het bijzonder, samen met de provincie West-Vlaanderen, de stad Brugge, de nationale loterij en enkele privé sponsoren. As each year, the College of Europe wishes to thank the European Union, the Belgian Ministry for Foreign Affairs, the Flemish regional and local authorities, the Polish government, and the many European national and regional governments, among which the Italian government and a number of Italian regions, as well as many private partners, for their continuous support. This support is essential if the college is to pursue its mission, which is to prepare young graduates to play a leading role in Europe or in third countries dealing with Europe in the coming years. Marie Skłodowska-Curie. This year marks the 100th anniversary of the Nobel Prize in Chemistry awarded to Marie Skłodowska-Curie, her second Nobel Prize, in fact. It does seem appropriate to choose this great scientist and remarkable woman who was born in Poland and achieved scientific fame in France as patron of the College of Europe 2011-2012 promotion. It also happens that the Radium Institute she helped create in Poland is located not far from our Natalin campus and that Poland holds the rotating presidency of the European Union. Marie Skłodowska was born in Warsaw in 1867 and died in Paris in 1934. However, today I will not present you an abridged biography of her or a detailed chronological account of her life. Rather, I would like to organize my presentation around a few telling pictures. Telling because they symbolize her achievements and her life trajectory. La première de ces photos est une photo prise lors du premier conseil Solvay au début de novembre 1911. Que voit-on sur cette photo? 24 personnes. Presque tous les grands noms de la physique du début du XXe siècle réunis à Bruxelles grâce à un mécène, l'inventeur et industriel belge Ernest Solvay. Parmi eux, entre autres, Henri Poincaré, Jean Perrin, Heinrich Lorentz, Ernest Rutherford, Max Planck, Paul Langevin et le jeune Albert Einstein, le patron de la promotion précédente. Tous des hommes, à une exception près, Marie Skłodowska-Curie, seule femme présente à ce congrès, assise à côté de Henri Poincaré, elle était alors âgée de 44 ans, et depuis plusieurs années déjà, elle était reconnue au nombre de tout grands savants de son temps. En 1903, à 36 ans, elle avait obtenu le prix Nobel de physique en compagnie de son mari Pierre Curie et de Henri Becquerel. Elle était la première femme à acquérir cette distinction. En 1906, après la mort de Pierre Curie, elle se vit offrir la chaire de physique à la Sorbonne, première femme à occuper une telle charge. En 1911, deux jours après le congrès Solvay, l'Académie des sciences de Suède lui décernait un second prix Nobel, celui de chimie, et cette fois à elle seule. Elle devenait ainsi la première personne à recevoir deux prix Nobel, ce qui à ce jour n'a été le fait que d'un nombre très restreint de savants. Marie Skłodowska-Curie fut aussi la première femme à devenir membre de l'Académie française de médecine, ce qui corrigea sa non-élection à l'Académie des sciences en 1911, non-élection de justesse due à un mélange de chauvinisme masculin et de conservatisme politique. Des recherches ayant valu à Marie Skłodowska-Curie ses deux prix Nobel et qui expliquaient sa présence au premier congrès Solvay, elle les avait menées 10 ans durant avec son mari Pierre Curie et elle les avait ensuite poursuivies seule après la mort accidentelle de celui-ci en 1906. La rencontre de Pierre Curie et de Marie Skłodowska en 1895, leur mariage en 1896, leurs 10 années de vie et de recherche commune dans des conditions de travail sommaires constituent à tous égards une belle aventure humaine que l'on a plus tard parée d'une aura quasi mythique, sinon même mystique. Elle, jeune diplômée polonaise, animée d'une intense ambition de découverte et qui venait d'acquérir très brillamment une licence de sciences physiques et une licence de sciences mathématiques à la Sorbonne, lui, jeune physicien français, à l'esprit concentré et à l'allure rêveuse. De 8 ans, son aîné, Pierre Curie, était déjà connu internationalement pour ses travaux en cristallographie, même si ses mérites scientifiques tardaient à être reconnus par l'université. À vrai dire, Pierre Curie et Marie Skłodowska ne poursuivaient pas plus un plan de carrière qu'ils n'ambitionnaient gloire sociale, récolte d'honneur ou richesse matérielle. Mais ces libres penseurs, elle avait abandonné la foi catholique, lui n'y avait jamais adhéré, étaient habités d'une religion commune, celle de la recherche scientifique désintéressée, conçue comme une contribution au progrès de l'humanité dans l'esprit positiviste de l'époque. En quête d'un sujet de thèse de doctorat, Marie Curie s'intéressa à la radioactivité produite par l'uranium. Ce phénomène consistant en la production par l'uranium et ses composés de rayons invisibles capables de traverser des parois opaques venait d'être mis en évidence par Henri Becquerel, dont les recherches s'inscrivaient elles-mêmes dans le prolongement de la découverte des rayons X par Röntgen. Les recherches entreprises par Marie et Pierre Curie permirent de mesurer de façon précise ce phénomène de radioactivité, et le terme radioactivité vient d'elle, et de découvrir, à partir du minerai d'uranium, deux substances nouvelles qu'elle nomma radium, en raison de la radiation, et polonium, ce dernier en l'honneur de la Pologne. Le radium produisant un rayonnement intense à distance, le second ne rayonnant que dans un très court espace. Certains ont estimé que Marie Curie n'avait été que l'assistante de son mari, ce qui n'est pas exact. S'ils travaillèrent ensemble, comme leurs notes de recherche le prouvent, si elle utilisait au départ de ses analyses une méthode mise au point antérieurement par Pierre Curie et son frère Jacques, il apparaît aussi que c'est elle qui eut l'intuition décisive, the decisive insight. Analysant l'intensité de la radioactivité produite par des matières premières contenant de l'uranium, elle se rendit compte que cette intensité n'était pas proportionnelle à la quantité d'uranium, mais beaucoup plus élevée. Elle en déduisit l'hypothèse que cette radioactivité très intense devait être liée à la présence, en très faible quantité, à côté de l'uranium, d'une substance inconnue, extrêmement radioactive. C'est alors que, comprenant tout l'intérêt de cette idée, Pierre Curie abandonna ses travaux en cristallographie pour se consacrer à la mesure de la radioactivité, tandis que Marie s'attachait à identifier et à isoler l'élément source de cette radioactivité intense. Et ce ne fut qu'au terme d'analyses longues et éprouvantes, qui prirent plusieurs années, que le radium put finalement être isolé, sachant qu'il n'est présent dans le minerai d'uranium que dans une proportion extrêmement infime, extrêmement limitée, à raison de 1/100 millionième. Marie Skłodowska Curie établit que la radioactivité était une propriété atomique du radium, propriété qui fut ensuite expliquée par le physicien néo-zélandais Rutherford. Le prix Nobel de 1903 apporta aux époux Curie, à Pierre en particulier, honneur, intérêt du grand public et attention des journalistes, chose qui leur pesait beaucoup, eux qui privilégiaient la quiétude et voulaient maintenir une vie privée. Mais ce prix Nobel eut au moins l'avantage de leur donner les moyens de poursuivre leurs recherches dans de meilleures conditions, lui devenant titulaire de la chaire de physique à la Sorbonne, elle devenant son chef de travaux en charge du laboratoire. Après la mort de son mari en 1906, Marie Skłodowska-Curie affina ses recherches concernant le radium, dont, entre-temps, les applications thérapeutiques, entre autres pour lutter contre le cancer, avaient été découvertes suite à un accident fortuit survenu au physicien Becquerel et à une expérience délibérée menée par Pierre Curie. Ni Pierre Curie, ni Marie Skłodowska-Curie ne voulurent prendre de brevet sur la méthode de production du radium, qui se développa ensuite de manière industrielle, ou sur ses applications. Nous connaissons maintenant les raisons de la présence de Marie Skłodowska-Curie au premier congrès Solvay de physique et des prix Nobel qui lui furent octroyés. Elle était la première femme dont l'œuvre scientifique fut reconnue et célébrée avec autant d'éclat par la société. Dès l'Antiquité, l'on trouve pourtant en petit nombre des femmes qui manifestèrent un intérêt et un talent certain pour la science. Ainsi, la fameuse Hypatie, qui à Alexandrie, au début du 5e siècle, fut mise à mort par des chrétiens fanatiques. À partir des 17e et 18e siècles, de véritables femmes de science apparaissent. Ainsi, la marquise du Châtelet, l'amie de Voltaire, qui traduisit du latin en français les principes de Newton en leur donnant une formulation plus intelligible et en améliorant la définition donnée par Newton à l'énergie. La marquise du Châtelet mourut en couche à 42 ans, après avoir eu 4 enfants, et ses œuvres principales, elle ne put pas les publier sous son nom. Le nombre de femmes de science s'accrut au XIXe siècle, et l'on peut citer ici de grandes mathématiciennes telles que Sophie Germain en France, Sofia Kovalevskaya en Russie. Toutefois, jusqu'à Marie Curie, et même après elle, ces femmes souvent souffrir de discrimination et ne furent pas reconnus à l'égard de leurs collègues masculins. Pensons ici à Maleva Maric, la première épouse d'Einstein, qui joua un rôle important mais méconnu dans la formulation mathématique de la théorie de la relativité restreinte. Ou encore à une physicienne allemande, Lise Meitner, qui aurait dû recevoir le prix Nobel pour ses travaux sur la fission nucléaire. Ou encore à Rosalind Franklin, plus près de nous, dont le nom aurait dû être associé à celui de Crick et Watson pour la découverte de la structure de l'ADN. Le petit nombre de femmes de science encore aujourd'hui tient dans une large mesure à la condition réservée aux femmes dans des sociétés dominées par des hommes et où, au départ, aux différences dans la façon dont hommes et femmes sont souvent éduqués, selon l'idée que seuls les mâles seraient capables d'une pensée rationnelle et de faire œuvre scientifique. Il y eut pourtant des penseurs, Platon dans l'Antiquité, Comenius et Poulain de Lavoir au XVIIe siècle, qui prônèrent une même éducation pour les hommes et pour les femmes au nom de leur égalité fondamentale. Il est d'ailleurs symptomatique de constater que, en règle générale, les femmes qui, dans le passé, se sont vouées à la science avaient bénéficié dans leur jeunesse d'une éducation libérale et de parents, de pères en particulier, qui n'avaient pas restreint leur horizon intellectuel. That was precisely the case of Maria Skłodowska. She was the fifth child of a Polish family belonging to the lesser nobility, but with limited financial means, as it had been dispossessed of its former land holdings as a result of the Russian occupation. Her father and her grandfather, on her father's side, had studied physics, and her mother was active in the field of education. In her family, the study of mathematics and science was not seen as the preserve of man. She grew up in Warsaw during a period of intense Russification and where the use of the Polish language was banned in state schools. She and her family were part of a segment of Polish society that one might call the Polish gentry, which would put great faith in education and in keeping Polish alive in order to ensure the survival of the Polish nation despite foreign occupation. Marie Skłodowska always ranked first of her class. Initially, she was interested in literature and she learned foreign languages, then became attracted by mathematics and science, and it is in Warsaw that she did her first experiments in a laboratory. As she could not undertake university studies in Poland, she needed to go abroad. However, due to her lack of financial resources, she worked for several years as a governess for two Polish families. Actually, she entered into a sort of pact with her eldest sister, Bronislava, who wanted to study medicine in Paris. Marie would help her, Marie, should I say, would help her family and Bronislava financially and would later join her in Paris. In the meantime, in parallel with her work as a governess, she would try to improve her background in mathematics and sciences in order to prepare herself to study at the Sorbonne. In 1892, when she was 25, she left Warsaw for Paris, and we know how successful she would be, first as a university student, then as a researcher and a scientist. She would, however, always keep contact with her Polish family and with Poland, where she often returned. It is also in Poland that she developed her love for nature and the countryside, which she would later share with her husband and her two daughters. It is also thanks to her Polish environment that she became passionate about education. She organized classes for young children in the Polish countryside, then would participate with some of her friends in Warsaw in the setting up of a kind of free academy where each would teach the others in his or her respective discipline. Later, after the death of her husband, she would create, with a few French colleagues, an informal school where their respective children would be taught mathematics and sciences in a relaxed and lively manner, this in combination with physical education and sports. Actually, two of these French colleagues, Jean Perrin and Paul Langevin, were also, as I mentioned, at the first Solvay conference of 1911, and they can be seen on the picture. Coming back to that picture, I now have to mention an episode in her life particularly painful for her, considering that she was a very private person. In early November, she was about to get her second Nobel Prize and was at the apex of her scientific career. However, at that very moment, 1 or 2 days after that picture had been taken, at that very moment, she was also about to enter into the eye of a violent public storm. We should look back at the picture, and among the famous physicists who appear in the picture, one sees, standing behind Marie Curie, to the right, next to Einstein, we see Paul Langevin, one of her French colleagues and a former student of her late husband. At the time that picture was taken, a French newspaper with a massive circulation, that today we would call a tabloid, published a front page article alleging that Paul Langevin, who had an unhappy marriage, and Marie Curie were united by more than their love for radium, that in fact they were lovers. And some of the letters Marie Curie wrote to Langevin, and which were later produced, show that indeed she felt passion for him. That would mark the start of an ugly smear campaign. The French conservative press, the same which had hounded Dreyfus, would call her a foreigner, that Polish woman who was responsible for breaking up a French married couple. She would be invited to leave the country. Neighbors would come to her house to insult her. She was even advised by a Swedish member of the Nobel Prize Committee not to come to Stockholm to pick up a second Nobel Award. She nevertheless went to Stockholm, replying with great dignity that her scientific achievements and her private life were separate matters. It seems quite likely that had she been a French male scientist, she would not have received the same shameful treatment. During that dramatic period of her life, she was able to count on the support of several friends, including Albert Einstein and Jacques Curie, Pierre's brother. Nevertheless, she ended up nervously in shatters. She fell gravely ill, and for almost a year, she interrupted her research work and lived in semi-seclusion. She eventually recovered. She did not leave France. She went back to her lab, and she did not show resentment vis-à-vis her country of adoption, as another picture illustrates. There, one sees Marie Curie driving a small van, carrying an X-ray mobile unit near the front line in northern France or in Belgium during the First World War. When war broke out in 1914, most of the male personnel working in research laboratories left to go fight the Germans. To be useful, Marie Curie launched a campaign for the purpose of equipping military hospitals with X-ray machines and also for installing X-ray machines on light vehicles, as one sees on the picture, whose engines would power the machines. That was her idea. and those mobile units could then be driven up to field hospitals close to the front line for the purpose of helping surgeons better treat wounded soldiers. She proved to be a master organizer. Not only did she come up with the idea of creating these mobile X-ray units, which would be called Les Petites Curies, she would also collect the money and the pieces of equipment needed, and she would instruct people how to use the X-ray machines. Moreover, often accompanied by her daughter Irene, she would herself go close to the front line and do X-ray photos of wounds suffered by soldiers. And in order not to depend on a driver, she learned how to drive and got a driver's license. Let us now move briefly to three other pictures. First, we see her in Washington in 1921, next to President Harding, and in 1929, next to President Hoover. Then, in a picture taken in 1932, we see her walking in Warsaw, next to the President of Poland, Mr. Mochiczewski, on her way to lay the cornerstone of the Radium Institute bearing her name, and which was designed to treat patients suffering from cancer. These three pictures are illustrative of the latter part of her life, the later part of her life, sorry. From the early 1920s until her death in 1934, she carried on her research work. Her lab in Paris attracted a growing number of young researchers, and among the brightest members of her team, one would find her daughter, Irène, and her husband, Pierre Joliot, who together would earn a Nobel Prize in Chemistry in 1935 for having discovered artificial or induced radioactivity. And when we see other pictures of the Solvay Conference, we see that one had to wait till 1935 to see two women on the picture, Marie Curie and then her daughter, Irène. During that period, 1920s, early 1930s, she would devote a significant part of her time raising funds for the establishment of Radium Institute. This meant that she had to accept to become a public person, courting presidents and kings, addressing large audiences, giving interviews to the press, becoming the constant subject of attention of many, all things she much disliked. Overcoming her initial reluctance, she went to the United States in 1921 on the initiative of an American journalist, Mary Maloney, who mounted a fundraising campaign among American women in order to buy radium for her Paris Institute. $100,000 were thus collected for the purchase of 1 gram of radium. In 1929, she went back to the United States, this time collecting $50,000 to buy radium for the future Polish Radium Institute. She, of course, deplored the way radium was being misused by some who, at the time, were taunting radium as a kind of universal cure. She was also aware, as much as Pierre Curie was, of the danger of radioactivity being used for military purposes. But she was an optimist, and she trusted mankind to put it to good use. During the 1920s, she was also a member of the International Committee on Intellectual Cooperation of the League of Nations, of which Albert Einstein was a member in and of. Marie Curie and Einstein had nurtured an enduring friendship, and one can see them together in an evocative picture taken in Switzerland in the early 1930s. By then, both had achieved iconic status in the eyes of world opinion. And her death in 1934 seems to have been the result of too much exposure to X-rays during the First World War. Et maintenant, pour conclure, les deux dernières photos. Celle du transfert en 1995 des restes de Marie Skłodowska-Curie et de Pierre Curie au Panthéon français par décision du président François Mitterrand. Elle se retrouvait là, en compagnie de ses collègues Jean Perrin et Paul Langevin, ce dernier avec lequel elle avait conservé des trois liens d'amitié jusqu'à sa mort. Elle était la première femme à bénéficier de cet honneur à titre propre et, ironie révélatrice, à compter parmi les grands hommes auxquels la patrie française exprime sa reconnaissance selon les mots inscrits au fronton du Panthéon et qui n'ont pas été changés depuis. Chers étudiants, j'espère que votre promotion sera fière de porter le nom de Marie Skłodowska-Curie, une grande savante, une femme intègre, courageuse, indépendante, indifférente aux modes et aux honneurs, et qui toute sa vie brûla d'une passion obstinée, celle de faire progresser la science dans l'espoir de contribuer au bien de tous. Je vous remercie de votre attention.